Very much for your presentations. Very well prepared and delivered. We've had a little change. Brad Grenand was not able to join us, so our presenters adjusted nicely and went a little longer and were more thorough in their presentations, which is great. We now have questions and from the audience, and we'll pass the mic, as we all know. Go ahead, Karen.
Karen Hunter, Elsevier. I have a question for Deborah. What at Wellesley specifically, so not the study, what have you learned from your patrons about their satisfaction with the program, and you know, and how many of them, particularly I'm curious, how many having bought the book would have done it again? In other words, was it really useful to them?
Can you give her the mic back? So the last part of the question, how many of them?
Well, I'm wondering that if as part of getting information, feedback from your patrons, you've asked them not only, you know, let's say, were they satisfied with the process of a patron-driven acquisition, but would they have, once having looked at the book more carefully, having bought it, if you will, rented it, would they have done it again? And would they got, was that, did that book really satisfy a need?
Okay. So I think the most important thing here is to know that we don't talk to our patrons about this. This is all completely seamless to the patrons. We are not promoting it. We're not discouraging it. We're putting it out there. We're putting the records in the catalog. We're integrating the content into all of our discovery services. But we're not talking about this service to people. Now, I individually, in my role as science collections manager, have relationships with faculty. And so I've had some conversations with faculty about the program and how the program works. It's kind of too much detail for faculty. They don't really want to know if that the first purchase is 10%, the second purchase is 10%, and the third purchase. And I've had to discourage faculty from even thinking about it, because I don't want them to think about, oh, this book, I'm going to, you know, I don't want them to think about it. It's just I want them to use what they want to use. So I've had some conversations with faculty about the program and about why we think it's so beneficial to us, and they've been interested and supported in that, in this new model. They love the broad access to the content. They love having access to things that they didn't think that we would have in the collection, and then there it is. So those have been some of my conversations with faculty. I've asked faculty, when I've received a request from a faculty member for a particular title, I've asked them, would it be okay if we expect that this book will be available as an ebook? Is it okay with you if I wait 3 or 4 months to see if it'll come in as an ebook and not buy the print book? And that's more general ebooks and not patron driven. But and they've said, oh, absolutely, let's wait for the ebook. But in general, we know that it's successful because it's being used more and more, and it's really growing, and our users are, we think that they're not only finding the books through the catalog, but they're also going in and doing searches within the aggregator and finding books that way as well. So in that sense, we think that it's been very accepted and successful.
Richard, am I coming your way?
Thank you. Hello, Richard Wynn from Aerie Systems. Another question for you. If the budget allocation is essentially delegated to the undergraduates in that they're deciding, that sort of means that publishers should redirect their marketing budgets from librarians directly to your students. And I'm wondering how you feel about that. And also, it probably has other implications in that, should I now create books with very long titles with every word that the student might search for so that it gets picked up electronically and is no longer any good for the shelf? So there's some interesting changes going to happen.
That's very interesting, especially that last part you were talking about how I had seen another presentation at another conference about the changes in, so you design books, titles, I guess, to fit on a certain size of a bind, the binding. And so that's all blown out of the water, right? Because nobody's looking at the print book on the shelf anymore. They're doing a search in a catalog. I wouldn't necessarily suggest, I think you're right. I think the marketing channel is different. I'm not sure that it's necessarily about marketing in places where student, you know, on Facebook. I don't know that that's, you all know better than I do. So, but yeah, I think you would be marketing more to the students. I don't expect, though, that students would say, oh, this is a, you know, I'm on Facebook and this is a great book for this project I'm working on. Maybe they would. You all would know that better than I would. But certainly, when they're doing a search through the catalog, they are searching generally. They would be searching on title, table. The table of contents would probably be in there. Maybe some a description of the book would be within, if they're doing a keyword search in the catalog. So that's if they're doing a search in the catalog. But if they're in the aggregator service, they can search the full text of the book. And so once they kind of get, we're not really promoting it that way, but once they get it, they're gonna search within the all of the full text of all of the books within the collection that we have access to. So they're gonna find things that you wouldn't have known that they would find. And that's definitely a change.
Sure, it's Alex Frost from PSL Group. Just one little follow-up on this because it's a great topic, and thanks for coming here. If there's full text indexing of the ebooks, I'm wondering if it runs the risk that those might be more discoverable than the collections that you already have.
Absolutely, so, and that's fantastic. I have no problem with that.
But does it mean that when you have a particular type of user who's looking for not a exact, specific, and precise reference, does it mean that you could be buying new books because they're finding these resources more easily when you have a comparable resource already in your holdings?
Yep, and that's fine. And so I'm not a traditional librarian, I would say. So I don't care. I want the users to have access to what they want and what they can use and what they need. And I think that they're not going to find it on the shelf because they can't find it on the shelf. So I think it's fantastic if they can find what they need just by doing the search.
We have one in the back.
Yeah, I'm Tim Babbitt from ProQuest. A quick question about the changing buying patterns associated with books and ebooks. When we went from having journals that are all print and they went the library served a central purchasing function that really discouraged faculty from acquiring the content themselves. And you know, we heard comments earlier today that talk about it, you know, disappearing from their bookshelf. In the book market for STM, or actually in general, is part of the usage pattern you're seeing because the faculty are buying the specific materials themselves, so the usage pattern doesn't really reflect a more broad use into the collection. But with E, you can have a broader use kind of perspective that will allow the faculty to take advantage of those kind of resources. I don't know if that was really a question. It was.
Yeah, I'm not really sure that I understand. I'm not sure that I understand the question. I'm sorry. I don't.
Do you want to try to rephrase? Or?
Yeah. So if you look at the faculty member right now, they don't get an option to get E for the most part. Okay.
Through the library.
Because
they don't get an option to get the electronic access to the book?
That's correct.
Okay.
Because they're using an iPad or they're using some appliance so that they can persistently hold on to it. The model that you're talking about is one where they rent the book for a short period of time. It doesn't become part of their library.
Oh, okay, right. So it's the personal collection of the faculty member as opposed to the library's collection that they're just using.
That's right.
So certainly I care about their access to the library's collection. And I mean, we have had some, I guess, I'm not sure that this is really your question either, but there have been some interesting conversations that I've had either with fellow librarians or with the faculty themselves that we will provide access to the ebook. If they like really just, if they really want this print copy of this book, to me, that's more like their, that's their own personal copy. And if they really want a print copy of the book, I think it's completely appropriate for them to buy their own copy. But not to ask me to buy a library copy and then have them check it out and leave it in their office for the next 20 years. That's not appropriate. And there are some settle down. So there are some interesting models out there too. There's certainly a big publisher that provides access to licensed ebook collections that provides a print on demand. So for a very low cost relative to the regular list price, so that if a faculty member sees the ebook, wants their own copy, they can buy with their own credit card for a very low cost a print-on-demand copy and have that. And I think that's a great model. The vendor that we use for eBook Library, they offer that the faculty member can buy their own e-copy, because they also have a commercial site that's just like individuals buying their own e-books. We don't really promote it or not, but if people want to do that, that's fine.
Hi, Dave Martinson from the American Chemical Society. I had a question for Bill. Just wondering on the click-through rates that you were talking about, how many of those actually are converted into some monetary transaction? So if I click on a link, that doesn't necessarily mean I'm going to actually rent the article. So on the click-throughs from the publisher site or on the trial, three free articles, how many of those do you end up actually having people spend money?
Hey Dave. So there's two sets of statistics we track, and one is the publisher conversion, not just net of not just to the registration, but net to the conversion. That is still the publisher links only went live about a month ago. So for most of the users that are registered, they haven't gone through their three article freebies. So we haven't seen anything yet. But I believe that's largely because they just haven't used everything up yet. I also think that users tend to be, as I mentioned in the talk, somewhat monthly behavior, so they come to the site, and we've seen, and we can see when our link gets displayed at a publisher site, we can see that's actually been displayed, even if it hasn't been clicked. That's how we get the click-through rate. So we know that there is a little bit of a pattern that certain days of the week and certain times of the month, at least we've seen so far, that earlier in the month it tends to get a little bit more traffic because the new articles come out, or maybe mid-month if that's the next release date. So that's still a question mark. I'm optimistic in the sense that we believe that users to our partner sites are regular visitors. My estimate is that the total, if I just swag all publisher traffic for the STM industry, I'm going to guess it's about $4 billion a year. Not uniques, but visitors. And I'm going to say about $2 billion if I just say half are about non-institutional visitors. And there aren't obviously $4 billion, much less $2 billion, scientists or technical folks or engineers out there. So there has to be a lot of repeat visitation. So we think that these will take repeated exposure for people to start to notice anything new on the site, because they've got a lot of muscle memory to do certain actions in certain ways almost instinctively. On our site itself, one of the limitations in our service is we're just getting started, and we have 30 to 40 publishers, not 300 to 400 publishers, and thousands of journals, not tens of thousands of journals. So we know that in many cases, when a user comes to our site and searches right now, we're going to disappoint them because we're not going to provide the best result that they could get from given that we don't have all the articles. We think that that will change over time. We are talking with more and more publishers, from medium-sized publishers all the way to the largest of the largest. And so we think that that will be remedied over time. But in the interim, what we look at to get an idea of engagement is we measure what we call an effective page view. So that is where the user is on the page for more than 30 seconds, which means that we think that that means they're actually taking the time to read that free sample. And those we get, I can't remember off the top of my head, I think it's about an 8% conversion of that user into a renter. And a revenue or rental per effective page view of about 35 cents, or about a $35 CPM. So And we knock on wood, we believe that our metrics will gradually improve over time for a variety of reasons. One is that the click-through rate on the publisher site, we hope that with repeated exposure, people recognize it, and more to the point, if they've clicked on it before, the next time they come back, they'll click on it again. And that once they've got an account with us, any ensuing rental, they won't even have to give their email address. They just click away, right? and it really will be a one click. And likewise, for visitors to our site, as they get more satisfaction that we've got the right information they're looking for and the brand starts to expand, that will lead to better metrics. But I always try and speak very plainly that we are seeing encouraging data, but there's no, we're not waving the flag and thumping the chest here. It's encouraging, but it's very preliminary, and we're just getting started. We think the most important thing is really just the experimentation and the learning that's going to come out of this, because I believe there is a silver bullet to get the right offer to that user at a price point that's going to be consistent with what our partners are marketing themselves. It's just a question of trying out various models to get to that right number, because there's clearly a demand there. So we think that there's certainly a way to solve that demand.
Any question back there?
Robert Harrington, AI. I love my iPad, so it's about an iPad, really. Are you going to do an iPad app for deep dives so you can do local rentals and...
Yes, we in fact, we ordered an iPad as well to try and play around with it, and so absolutely. It's probably going to be at this rate at the second half of this year. Our plan, we've got a release coming up right now where we will be expanding price tiers to allow our partners to, so we're going to be adding beyond 99 cents, $1.99 and $2.99, to one, see whether there's, you know, what the changes in conversion rate are going to be like. But we also think it'll be very interesting for our partners, because we will allow the user to, or the partner rather, to set price by journal or by date range or both. So you could have every article within the last 6 months is $2.99, and then everything over 5 years is 99 cents or free or whatever you want to do. So that's taking precedent right now. But we are bullish on iPad and what it will do toward netbooks You never hear anyone with a Kindle saying, "Gosh, why can't I print that thing?" It is presumed when you get a Kindle, it is a read-only experience, and we hope that and believe that the iPad will start to transform user expectation that reading it is perfectly fine, and the printing is only when needed. Right now, I think, and we face this challenge, is that most users, it's, I get it, I print it, you know, and then I throw it away. You know, very few really need to print it and mark it up if we could give them the right reading experience. So we think the trend is toward more and more mobile, unattached, and read-only type experiences, and which I think will favor the model we're trying to pursue.
Another question for Bill. Fred Dilla from AIP. I know you've gotten this question from probably all of your partner publishers, but it'd be good for everyone to hear you answer it. How robust do you feel your rent-to-view system is, so it doesn't damage the buy experience?
Right. We think it's there is a workaround. That's a print screen, and we've done it ourselves to test it. We've had our partners send us their content print screen to say, "Hey, look what we can do." And so there is a quote, you know, hack. I've looked at it. Even using, you know, print screens on Macs where you're going to get a pretty good resolution, it's pretty poor. You know, it's not, it's probably a customer you would never get anyway. Let's put it that way. If they really are willing to endure a print screen to then they're probably, in the absence of deep dive, they're going to get, if they're willing to go through that pain and trouble, they're going to probably get your stuff anyway through some less legal means. But we, you know, our view is we are going to constantly be looking at the security of that, because again, the reason I think we've gotten decent relationships with our partners is because we've been very transparent about what we're doing and we've aligned our interests with them. And so if our partners see erosion in their business, we're only as good as our partners are doing. Let's put it that way. So we that is the security and the workaround or lack of workaround is vitally important to us.
Question from here.
This is for Deborah again. Tim Murray, Cambridge University Press. You mentioned YBP and serial solutions, and my e-library.
E-book library. Not mine.
Oh, okay.
E-book, there are two different vendors.
Right.
E-book library is mine.
So what does the channel look like for patron-driven acquisition? Like, who are all the players and what are they all doing?
So the question is, would the order come through Gobi, Yankee Book, YBP's Gobi versus coming through a deposit account with somebody with an aggregator, that type of thing? That's what we're trying to get at.
Right.
So I guess I can address that question with the vendors that I mentioned, and then I might forget some others that I haven't mentioned. So we use eBook Library as our aggregator for patron-driven acquisition, and they partner with publishers, of course. So we provide access to the collection that we've set up through our profile. We've set up a profile in eBook Library to identify the titles that we want and the titles that we do not want included in our collection. Right now, the way that's working, then we need to get those. We need to get MARC records for those titles into our catalog. eBook Library has a service where they would provide the MARC records, and we would just load those MARC records into our catalog. We were not happy with the quality of those records, and so we chose to use Serial Solutions, which does a variety of services for us. We license multiple modules from them, but one of the modules that we license is their MARC record service, which originally was providing MARC records for e-journals, so like an EBSCO database that might have 5,000 titles, we would get records from Serial Solutions for the titles that are in the EBSCO database. But they also provide a book record, an e-book record service. So right now, the way we do it is we get a list from eBook Library of all of the titles that are in our collection on a monthly basis, because things are added to our collection on a monthly basis. A few titles every month are removed through whatever situation is going on between the publisher and eBook Library. Some titles are removed, titles that we have not purchased. If we purchased the titles, we would continue to have access to them. So we get the set of, an Excel spreadsheet. We send it to Serial Solutions. They upload it into their database, and we download MARC records from them and import them into our library system. So that's how we work with Serial Solutions. And then, I'm sorry, did you?
And YBP.
So YBP is our book vendor. When I, as a selector, am buying content, buying print books or ebooks. So YBP, the Gobi service, includes, it's our ordering service. So I would go in, if I knew there was a book that I wanted to buy, I would locate the book in the database. I would identify whether it was a book that was only available in as print title or if it were available as an ebook. And they work with, so generally, not all of the ebook options are in there. It's only those specific publishers that they have the content in there for. So the selector has to be aware of that. But so I would see this is an ebook that I could buy through eBrary. It's an ebook I could buy direct from the publisher, or it's an ebook I could have access to an eBook Library. So then I, as a selector, make a decision at that point. It might already be in our eBook Library collection. So I might just want to let it ride, not do a purchase, but just wait and see if it gets used. Or I might know this is like the exact title that this course needs, and I can avoid some of the short-term loan costs, and I'll just go ahead and buy it.
So would it be fair that to say that if the patron-driven acquisition model became more prevalent in your library, that you'd order less titles through your YBP, Gobi, and more titles would come through EBL, probably?
Yes, and I can say in the sciences, when I'm doing my collecting now, so I might go through book reviews, I might go through choice reviews, I make publisher catalogs, and about This is completely, there's no like evidence for this except for my what it feels like to me, but it feels like about 30% of the books that I would have firm ordered, I'm letting ride because they're in our ebook library collection.
Okay. Question here, in the middle.
Barry Dunn from Chemical Abstract Service. I have a question for Andrea. To bring you in. I found your concept of personas very interesting. Can you help us understand a little how you find the right balance between too granular to be too unmanageable versus too generic? As you mentioned, it's an archetype of user attributes.
Right. Depends on what you want to do with the persona. So if the persona is really being created based on research that, for example, a small product team might be using to build a product, it would need to be fairly granular. If, though, we're building personas as some of the ones I showed you in the flip charts, the booklet and the little trading cards where we're passing them out to everybody in the organization just to help them understand who the user is and what they might be doing, not granular at all. So we can go from minutia, where I showed you one that was by the hour, we actually do them by the minute. And we will look, if somebody is using an online product, we actually do it by every 5 seconds. And we do have some sophisticated tracking software, eye tracking software, where the user is wearing, so we can see where they're looking, what they're thinking, how their thought process works as they look at a screen of data, and we'll incorporate that into a persona. But that's a very robust and time-consuming, so you're going to have to build a very large, expensive product if you're going to spend that kind of time.
I have one follow-up question for Bill, and then we'll open up to a final question if we have it after that. Just, have you done any research or have any knowledge on identifying the actual user of your service and how they, whether they're coming from an institution? Because you mentioned earlier, you know, how they're not accidental tourists, they're repeat users. And obviously the key to successful, you know, business is having work for the partners well and the concern of cannibalization. So I'm just wondering if you try to correlate that. Are these users coming from the IP address of the university versus somewhere else?
Yeah, in fact, I was talking with someone earlier this morning, and we were talking about Google Analytics, which is what we use, and some of the inherent limitations of trying to do tracking in Google Analytics. So the short answer is we have all the data, but we're now going to have to do a custom report to provide that back. And we will be sharing that with our partners, which is we can't show individual identity, obviously, because of privacy, but we will be developing a standard report that shows top 25 IP address and domains and top 25 email address domains, because when users register with us, they have to provide their email address. Rarely we ask, but rarely do they give us organization or title. And we'll provide that back to our partners so that our partners can see, you know, obviously, if you know, to get an idea of the profile, but obviously if they see a corporation, for example, that gives them an opportunity to reach out to them directly for a subscription opportunity. So we will be providing that, but we don't have that right now.
Time for one last question if we have it. Well, I'm going to ask it. Oh, here we go. There we go. One last question.
I'm Carol Meyer from Crosswalk. This is for Andrea. I thought it was a really interesting presentation. I thank you for it. I was just wondering, in the whole grand scheme of, you know, users don't really say what is true, do you find in your process any use for sort of more traditional things like focus groups?
My group does not do focus groups. We really are a one-on-one organization, but we combine the market research, which is typically focus groups, online surveys, phone calls, your typical market research is incorporated, and then of course we also do a lot of web analytics, because again, what they're doing is more important to us than what they're telling us that they're doing. And when you ask a user what they do and then you have the web analytics to show what they did, and you say, really, that's what you did, and you talk them through the process, sometimes the light will go on for them, and say, maybe that's not really what I do. I don't really know what I do. And that's typically an answer that we get. But watching people and using that data that we have from the market research and from web analytics is very helpful. And if you catch me later, I'll tell you some fabulous non-publishing examples of why this came about and is used so heavily, based on some things from Toyota and Avon Cosmetics that are really interesting about what people say and what they do and how different they are.
Very well. Thank you very much. It was a terrific presentation. It was good Q&A. So I appreciate you.